Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome. We're glad that you're here. A blogger that I follow said, this morning is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and tonight is Christmas Eve. That seems like a pretty good way to do it on these weird Sundays. But 7 o'clock tonight is when the festivities begin with the prelude, and the worship service starts at 7:30, and I hope to see you all there. We're glad that you're here this morning. And before the prelude, which is played by somebody you've all known, Brandon Burns is back for today. But before he does the prelude, Kathy wants to explain what it is about. So,
good morning. We do welcome Brandon back this morning to play for our service of worship. I'm just so glad he could be with us. And he thought it would be a good idea if you all had a little thing about the prelude this morning. It might help you understand it a little bit more when you hear it. So think of the angels coming out of the sky to tell the shepherds of Jesus' birth. The sudden light, the ghostly images, voices from the sky. And in the Messiah, it says, they were sore afraid. But then the good news was shared.
Thank you. Please stand in body or spirit and join together in the Advent reading. Today, we light the candle of love. We light these candles as a sign of the coming light of Christ. Advent means coming. We are preparing ourselves for the days when the nations shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The Lord will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son, and you shall name him Emmanuel. God is with us. Let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Please join me in the prayer of praise and adoration. Your face has shone upon us, O God, in the young woman who is with child. She will bear a son and name him Emmanuel, God with us. Your presence shall hereafter be a source of comfort and guidance to all that call on your name. Your footsteps shall accompany us. Your breath shall give us new life. Your arms will console us, and your hands will be there to welcome us home. You are a God for all seasons, and give us all reason to worship your name. Amen.
Thank you.
let us continue our prayers and confess our sins. You shower gifts on your people, O God, and forgive their faults. We keep accounts and settle old scores. You make peace, sending Christ as a sign of reconciliation and hope. We make war and call it peacekeeping. You give us a source of confidence as your Spirit is sent into our midst. We cause others to be restless in our anxiety and self-concern. Have mercy upon us, forgive and free us, that we may be renewed to serve your people with goodwill. Amen. And unto us a child is born and a son is given, who shall save his people from their sins. And in Jesus Christ our sins are forgiven. Amen.
Join me in the prayer of illumination. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first lesson comes from Luke 2, verse 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to invite all children and youth to come down for Time for Young Disciples. Come on down. Good morning. We are so glad to have you two here this morning. Morning, Shinlin. Good morning. All right. So today is Christmas Eve, which means tomorrow is what? Christmas. That's right. So I don't know about you, but our family, we've had a couple family Christmases already, so we've been opening gifts already, but tomorrow we get to open gifts, right? And that's so exciting and fun. What? You could do other things. That's right. There are other things to do on Christmas other than open presents. Thank you for that lovely segue. Yes. So... but we've been learning lessons for Advent, right, in our Time for Young Disciples. So we first started learning about Mary, and the angel Gabriel told her to do not be afraid, right? And she wasn't. She said, I will do what God has asked of me, right, to be Jesus's mother. And so when we are asked of God to do things for him, we shouldn't be afraid. And then we learned about John, right? John the Baptist, whose purpose in life was to go and to tell others that Jesus was coming, right? Jesus was coming. And so God asks us to do that now as well. But then our next lesson was, well, when we go out and we talk to people, what do we tell them? And we tell them that Jesus is the Son of God, right? Who came to earth to save us. And he loves us. So... while all the gifts and all the magic and sparkle of Christmas is fun, we always need to remember and come back to the fact that Christmas is all about Jesus, and he was the greatest gift that was ever given, right? The greatest gift that was ever given. So when you open your presents tomorrow and you spend time with your loved ones, remember that Jesus is the greatest gift of all, and that is why we celebrate Christmas. Right? So if you are going to blast, you're going to go with Margie over there. She's coming this way. But before we do that, let's say a prayer together. You ready? You ready, Shinlin? All right. Here we go. All right. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for sending your son to save us. Amen.
We continue our reading from the Gospel according to Luke, picking up chapter 2 with verse 8 and reading through verse 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for see, I'm bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace among those whom he favors. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. The word of the Lord. So here we have another song in the Christmas story. This is the song that the angels sing, the Savior is born. And the shepherds hear this out in the field at night. And I read once that shepherds were considered like outcasts. They were like the motorcycle gang people that hang around the mall, you know, with the tattoos and the leather clothes. And no one really liked them, and people were kind of scared of them. And I went on and really embellished that. And after the sermon, one of the world's experts on sheep, Jim Althouse, came over with his cane and said, "I don't know where you got your information, but you're all wrong, you see. If the shepherds were not gentle, the sheep wouldn't have anything to do with them. So you're all wrong." And he left. I said, "Well, I'm never preaching about shepherds again." So I really don't know what to say, except that they were awake at that hour, 4 o'clock in the morning or whatever it was, and heard the angels. And the angel says, "A Savior is born in Bethlehem, the city of David, and the Savior will be the Messiah. And this is for all the people." And then a multitude of the angels appear and say, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." So this is called the Gloria. We looked at the Magnificat, and we looked at the Benedictus, and we looked at whatever the other one was. And this is the Gloria. And it's used all through church history. It was used from earliest times in worship. And by the 3rd century, it was common to the whole church, and it was used extensively. The Reformers knew it and used it, and Protestants knew it and used it really until our time. Some places, they still use it every week. It's this modern notion that we know better than our forebears that's gotten us into trouble. But this is something that people in the church have always sung. And the whole thing is this: "Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen." It's a little more than what the scripture says the angels actually said, but it's in the same spirit. Now, usually when angels appear in the scripture, there's a bright shining light. The glory of God surrounded Moses on Mount Sinai. The Hebrews were led through the wilderness by a pillar of fire. Isaiah sees the glory of the Lord in the temple, and the smoke of God's light fills the temple. So we often see the angels as bathed in light, the uncreated light of God shining around them. It's God's glory. And the angels say, well, this glory is now coming because of the birth of Jesus. Jesus himself appeared in glory at the Transfiguration in front of 3 of his disciples. Glory then to God. Praise to God. Praise to God Most High in highest heaven. And with that praise comes peace to those who praise God, men of goodwill as King James Version put it. So then we hear, Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. So God is the King and the Lord, and also, though, the Father. God is worth praising, worthy of all adoration and attention. He's the ruler of heaven and earth, and he's not some idol in the corner that you can turn and walk away from. He won't be ignored. He's our King, though, and we owe him then our loyalty and service and allegiance. We give him thanks, and this is the way we orient our lives in thanksgiving. Now, the good old Westminster Catechism started off, what's the chief end of man? And the answer is, man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. So giving God glory is what we're put here for. That's our purpose. The rest of it's just busy work. But as soon as we begin praising God, we become aware of our own issues and shortcomings, what one pastor used to call our own screwed upness. We realized, as Paul put it, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That fallen short, a word is like when you shoot an arrow and it doesn't quite make it to the target and fall short in the grass. That's falling short of God's glory. And so we keep going and we pray then, Lord God, Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Well, there you go again. Jesus is the one who takes away our sin. He's Lord. Now, in the first century, that was enough to get you in trouble with the Romans, because everybody knew that Caesar was Lord, not Jesus. And the Jews used it to refer to God alone. And so to say Jesus is Lord is a radical claim. It could get you into trouble. And he's the only Son of the Father. Okay, here we get into trouble because of the translators. The ancient songs actually say he's the only begotten Son of the Father. And you say, well, so what? What's the difference? If he's the only begotten Son of God, he's the Son of God, right? Move along. But in the scripture, only begotten becomes a sort of technical term that signifies the special nature that Jesus has with the Father. He's not like the rest of us. He's fully human, but he's just not like the rest of us. Only begotten reminds us he's Son in terms of relationship to God, and he's the Son, so he is the Lord God. And he's also the Lamb of God. If you look at Revelation chapter 5, you have a vision of the Lamb that was slain, and that Lamb is praised in the same terms, the same words that the Father is. The Lamb of God is sacrificed and sins are forgiven somehow. He takes away the sin of the world. So we sing God's praises, and then we realize our own sin, and we praise Jesus who will take them away. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God. And again, this is how we live our lives, praising God. But praise is empty unless it has memory. We praise God who delivers us, who forgives our sins, who lifts us out of all of that. Well, it continues. You're seated at the right of the hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. According to the Apostles' Creed, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. The older English versions used to say, sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And people in seminary used to joke, well, if he's sitting on the right hand of the Father, does the Father's hand go to sleep? You know? Does it start to tingle? Those are jokes, you know. Christ is seated at God's right hand. That's the place of honor at a feast. Jesus has the best seat of all. Now, our informal age has forgotten all these things, but not everybody's forgotten. About 30 years ago, the Queen of England came to the White House. And that was the year that Price Gwynne, who was the CEO of Lance Crackers in Charlotte, was the moderator of the General Assembly. And the moderator serves for a year and then goes to the next assembly and chairs the meeting just long enough to elect a new moderator. And then, as my mentor used to put it, he's the loneliest man in the Presbyterian church because he has nothing to do. So we took him to lunch. And he said, yeah, he received a request from the British government that he be at the White House at a certain day when the Queen arrived. So he went. He was kind of mystified, but there he went. And he found himself in the receiving line between the president and the Archbishop of the Episcopal Church. And all the Brits seemed to know exactly who he was. And all the Americans were angry that this nobody is here upstaging the rest of us. The White House staff couldn't believe it. He just came in here and acts like he's somebody. And he's getting the royal treatment. Well, perhaps you remember that as the result of all the religious conflicts in England over the centuries, the monarch is the head of the church, which is the Church of England, the Episcopal Church, when in England. But when the monarch goes to Scotland, he or she becomes Presbyterian. And so protocol calls for the head of the Episcopal Church and the head of the Presbyterian Church to stand next to each other in the lines, ahead of all the other government somebodies. And so there he was. Because, the moderator, that's the most head guy we've got, so we sent him. He said he shook hands with the Queen, and then he had a few cheese straws, and everybody was ignoring him, so he just left. The Brits know how to honor people. The Brits know what protocol demands and how you do things. They've preserved all these traditions that, democracy, we throw them out. Well, here we see in the song the same kind of thing. Jesus has the prime spot, the best seat in the house. And there he has God's attention. And what does he do? He intercedes for us. We ask him to hear our prayers, to receive our prayers, to pray for us, to deliver us, to forgive us, to strengthen us day by day for the joys and sorrows that will be ours. And we're not left desolate then. We're not bereft of hope. We have an intercessor who never forgets us. And we have a God who loves us endlessly and is full of mercy and wants only our good. Sometimes we might feel like nobody could love us, not even God. Sometimes we may think, well, God, even God can't forgive this. And sometimes we pull away, sure that there's no mercy for us. But Jesus is there interceding for us at every turn. So never give up. Never despair. Jesus never gives up on us. And then the song ends with a little bit of Trinitarian praise. You alone are the Holy One. You alone are Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Spirit, in the glory of the Father. It's sung to Jesus, but it uses the same words that we sing to God the Father. And so we enter into a mystery. Jesus says the Father and I are one. They're one in substance, though differentiated in person by love. And you figure out what that means, you get an instant master's degree. The Trinity is a great mystery. But here we see that Jesus is the Holy One of Israel, the same title used in the Old Testament for God. And so Jesus, born of Mary in the night, is announced by angels and welcomed by shepherds, and this Jesus is God. And that's the Gloria. We sing it. Surely the angels did not sing it in Latin. They might have, who knows? And we sing pieces of it all through our hymns. We sing the Gloria Patri most weeks. That's known as the little doxology in liturgical terms. Sometimes we even sing the blues version that's in the new hymnal. But however we sing it, we should sing it day by day. We should sing it, for it represents and recognizes and praises God, our benevolent Father. It recognizes, praises, and asks for mercy from Jesus. And it leaves us lifted into the mystery of the Trinitarian God who creates, redeems, and sustains the whole world. So this Christmas, sing. Sing to the glory of God. So glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Thank you.
Please remain standing and join me in our affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
As we gather for prayer, let us keep in our prayers Lee Branford. She was in the hospital till a couple of days ago. Dennis DeBalso had a couple of stents put in after a mild heart attack, and I think he is still in the hospital. And Rick Knowles' brother died in Raleigh. And so we keep them in our prayers. Let us pray. In the midst of the celebrations and the fun and the festivities, the mirth of Christmas, O Lord, we know that not everyone celebrates. Not everyone is joyous and happy. Some people are sick. Some people are in grief. Some people are dying. And we remember them. We remember what it is like to not be happy. But we know that no matter our mood, no matter how we feel, no matter how our health goes, you are with us and you sustain us moment by moment. You give us true joy. And you remind us always of the love of God that passes all understanding. And so we give you our thanks and praise, Lord God, thanking you for the birth of the Christ, and thanking you for his life and his teachings and his death and his resurrection, and thanking you that through him, we are all accepted, saved, made your people. And so we give you thanks, O God, now and forever. And on Christmas Day, we look around and we see the world. What a place. We pray for the Ukraine. We pray for peace in Ukraine. And we pray for Israel and Gaza. We pray that both sides would stop killing people. And we pray for peace there. And all the other places in the world, Guatemala comes to mind. We pray that you will lead the people to peace, lead them to lay down their arms, lead them to work together for the good life for all people. And we pray for our own streets, our own towns, that there would be peace in our towns. peace between people of different religious and political persuasions, peace between people of different races, peace. Give us peace, O God. We give you thanks for those who serve our country to protect us from those who don't want peace. We ask you to bring them home safe and sound to those who love them. And we pray for those who serve the public in elected office. We pray for those who serve as teachers. We pray for all of those who serve the public's greater good, that you would bless their efforts and their work. And we pray, O God, for each other, for the needs that are spoken and the needs that are unspoken, the ones that are obvious to us and the ones that aren't. Be with us all, O Lord. Remind us what Christmas is about. Give us peace. And we pray that in Jesus' name. We pray the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
let us pray together. The stage is set for the presentation of your gift of life, O Christ, and we are part of the company of players. As the curtain is about to rise, we prepare ourselves for our roles. We commit that we have to the drama that changes lives. Help us to step onto the stage with anticipation and hope. May we know the script so well that we shall not falter as we share your gift and ours. Amen. So go in peace, go and rejoice, go and know that as you go, all the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit goes with you. May you have a blessed Christmas. Amen.